Hope it's nice and sunny where you are. It's not in Nottingham, but anyway, it is July, isn't it? So morning, everybody. Who have we got on today? Hi, Andrew and Ben up in Yorkshire. Hi, David over the water there in Northern Ireland. Emily, hi. Imogen, hi, hope you're well. Chris, Mark, there's lots of Marks on here. Peter, Ravenska, hope you're well in Warrington. Anyway, morning. Morning, everybody. So today's session, 10 practical ways to use your Google and VouchedFor reviews to improve your marketing. 10 practical ways to use your Google and VouchedFor reviews to improve your marketing. And put up a poll. We're going to do two polls today, one at the start and one at the end. 65% of people have voted so far. So if you've not gone and voted in the poll, please go and do so while we just have a quick chat about what we're going to talk about today, and then we'll start by looking at the poll results. So today, what are we going to cover? We're going to start by talking about why online reviews are important. We're then going to talk about why Google and VouchedFor, and then we're going to look at 10 ways you can use those reviews to improve your marketing and where you should be adding them on your website. And then we're going to finish off by talking about how to boost your review count. Every week, I speak to advisors and planners who are making the same mistakes when it comes to collecting Google and VouchedFor reviews. And it's really important that we, as we'll show in a bit, we build that review count. And if we're going to make those mistakes, then we're going to get fewer reviews. So I thought we'd finish by how to boost your review count. And then I need everybody's help, please. We're going to miss August, holidays, et cetera. So we're not going to do a webinar in August, but we're going to come back in September. And I could do with your help as to what we should be talking about. So we'll do a poll about that at the end. So hand over to Dan for the usual housekeeping. Please do. 75% now so far. Please go and do vote in the poll. Dan, over to you, mate.
Sure thing. Wow, the sun. What's that, Phil? I don't think I've seen the sun in about a month. Yeah, let's do some housekeeping. So I'm Dan. I'm the head of branding and design here at Yardstick. And my job, as always, is to make sure everything's running smoothly and to keep us on track and on time. I'll also be keeping an eye on any technical issues, and any questions that you may ask. So looking at the attendees here, so we've got plenty of familiar faces in the crowd today. So you guys will know that these sessions work best with lots of input. We'll be talking about how to use your Google and VouchedFor reviews. So if you want to add to that conversation, don't be shy. Let's hear what you've got to say. Ask questions, share your experience of what has and hasn't worked. Tell us if we're speaking sense, and of course, tell us if we're speaking the opposite. These sessions are an opportunity for us to learn from you as well. So let's see what we can all get into. And as usual, there are two ways that you can get involved. Either use the chat function, or there's a Q&A box that I'll be monitoring as well. We're reading your questions out at natural breaks. And then, of course, we'll have a period at the end where we can sweep any final ones up. And a question that we get asked often, so I'll answer it now. A follow-up email with a recording of this session will land in your inbox later on. So if you do miss anything the first time around, you can absolutely catch up later. Okay, so without further ado, Phil, we've already spoken about how to get reviews in the first place. So how do we weaponize them? Tell us everything.
Weaponize them is a good word. One person we should explain their absence of this week is Abby. Abby has flown south for the sun. So she messaged me earlier and said it's only 31 degrees today.
Hi.
It was about 38 yesterday. So that's why Abby's not here today, everybody. And you're stuck with me and Dan. So how do we weaponize these reviews? I like that. That's a blog title there. I think the first thing we do is we try and look at some of the barriers people are experiencing. So on the way in, we asked a question on the poll. What's stopping you from promoting your reviews more effectively? 14% of people said they didn't have enough time. Well, that's good. So at least we've got the time to do this. Half, 51% of people said they don't know where to start. So you're in the right place. We're going to be able to tell you where to start today. 16% said you don't have enough Google reviews to promote, which is okay. And that's fine. we will come to that at the end of this presentation. And then 90% of people said something else. And if you put something else, just put something in the chat, would you please, just to explain what that something else is. But it's pretty clear that about half the people on here don't know where to start when it comes to promoting their Google and VouchedFor reviews. Well, the answer to that is we start right here. So let me end the poll and we'll plow on. Right, so let's start by looking at why reviews are important. And that's because we want to use reviews to impress prospective clients on their digital journey to your door. And every prospective client takes several steps on that journey. And it's something we call at the Yardstick, the inquiry equation. The inquiry equation. So let's give a couple of examples. Let's say I am recommended to Andrew up at Berry and Oak in Boston Spa. In my early 60s, I've got a pile of pensions, investment savings, not really sure what's going on, out on a Friday night. And I ask a friend who they recommend, and they say, go to Andrew at Berry and Oak. So next morning when I wake up, dust off the hangover, because I'm not as young as I used to be, I Google Berry and Oak. And then I go onto Berry and Oak's website and make an inquiry from there. So the equation there is referral from an existing client, Google search, website equals contact with Berry and Oak. Other examples of the inquiry equation. I might drive past the office of a financial planner every day on the way into work. Get to that point in my life when I need to do something about my retirement planning. So I search for that firm online. I look at their Google reviews, and that's enough to convince me to pick up the phone to them. And the telephone number is in the Google business listing. Last example. I'm a member of a local Facebook group where people are talking about, you know, cats getting lost and up trees and that sort of stuff. And about once a week, someone will go on there and say, can you recommend a mortgage advisor? Can you recommend a financial advisor? And I will often suggest people. So the inquiry equation there is what? Facebook group, recommendation from other members of the Facebook group, probably a Google search, maybe straight through to the website and inquiry. So people take several steps on their digital journey to your door, and we need to impress them on those steps. And that's because sat between someone becoming aware of a financial advisor or planner and taking action is Google. I'll give you another example. Let's say I'm out for dinner. I'm that 60-year-old person. I'm out for dinner, turn to one friend and they say, Andrew Elson at Berry and Oak. And the other one says, no, you don't want to use Andrew. Sure, he's nice, but you don't want to use Andrew. You want to use Ben Cordiner at Cordiner Wealth. So I come away with two names. And in times gone by, pre-internet and pre-Google, I'd have probably just picked up the phone to Ben or Andrew on the Monday morning. Whoever answered first, I would have made an appointment with. But now Google has made us all more discerning consumers. We all have more information at our fingertips. So instead of waiting to Monday morning, I'm probably going to search online for Andrew and Ben. Whoever impresses me most, I'm going to get in touch with first. And interestingly, this is where competition happens. Competition rarely happens around the meeting room table or Zoom call, as it is these days. It happens online and it's invisible. Andrew and Ben don't know I've been recommended to them in that instance. So you've got to impress potential clients on their digital journey to your door. And one of the best ways of impressing potential clients is through online ratings and reviews. We talk about three social proof boxes at Yardstick: client surveys, client videos, and online ratings and reviews. And as we wrote about a few weeks ago in a blog, three key stats to prove the importance of online reviews. And I hear advisors often saying, oh, my clients don't read reviews. High net worth clients aren't interested in reviews. Well, I'm sorry, But that opinion doesn't override this evidence. And Bright Local's research show that 81% of consumers say that online reviews are either important or very important when deciding to use a particular company. 87% of consumers use Google to evaluate local businesses. And local is really important because whilst you can operationally deliver a service via Zoom to people anywhere in the country or indeed the world, a lot of consumers want local advice. And then one in three new clients say that they read an advisor or planner's vouched for reviews, becoming a client. And Bobby, we put something in the chat earlier, and that's the first stat, I guess, to show that vouched for reviews are incredibly visible. So that research from Bright Local and Vouched For shows how important online reviews are in the context of that digital journey to your door. So hopefully that's a little bit of background about why online ratings and reviews are important. We'll look at which platforms we should be using in a second. But Dan, there's a few notifications in the chat. Mm. Anything we need to deal with so far?
So these are mainly notes from the poll. And overwhelmingly, people are heading more down the vouched for route as opposed to the Google route. And a lot of pain points that people are getting, a few people have mentioned that they don't focus on Google reviews because they have a habit of disappearing. We've got David who says, we focus on vouched for and are getting quite good at getting those reviews, but I'm not asking for Google reviews as it seems like overkill. Am I missing out? How does one get client to do both? And Imogen backs that up. We have the same issue, building up a good stock of vouched for reviews, but struggling to get people to actually leave those Google reviews.
Okay. So reviews disappearing, struggling to get people to leave Google reviews, and feels like overkill. Right, okay, we'll deal with all of those three. Dan's writing down, and we'll deal with all those three of the next few slides for me, yeah? The one thing I would say, I'd deal with one of them straight away. Unless, I'm not sure who left that comment, but unless you've got a different experience, Google reviews do occasionally disappear. It doesn't happen that frequently. So we've got 136 five-star Google reviews. It's a bit of a shameless plug, but why not? We've got 136 five-star Google reviews. And we have one disappear once every 6 months, something like that. It's a pain in the neck because you've got to submit a request to Google to get it back. But it is by no means enough of a problem for me to not want to collect Google reviews, or not suggest to everybody on this call that you collect Google reviews. Another example, just to prove that point, we've got a firm in Bristol last month. I hope you can all hear me. It's absolutely throwing it down here. Last month, they lost two Google reviews. They just vanished. They submitted the online form to Google, and Google have put them back on. So that's a real, real win. So let's deal with that's one of the ones there, Dan. We'll cover the other two as we go through the next couple of slides. And this slide, the next couple, are really explaining why we believe you should ask and use two platforms. So Google reviews, they can be hard to get. I think we've established that from all our research in the past and what a few people have said so far. They are incredibly hard to get. For every one Google review you get, you'll get between 5 and 10 on vouched for. But they do help improve your local search rankings. So if you imagine someone typing into Google, financial advisor near me, financial advisor Nottingham, Brighton, Norwich, whatever it is, and think about the page that the consumer sees, some adverts at the top. You've then got Google Places, which is a section of local businesses. About 40% of people who are looking for a local service will click on there, and Google reviews are a ranking factor. So the more Google reviews you get, the more likely you are to be placed in the three businesses that are in that box. So that's a really good reason to be looking and trying to increase your Google review count. Plus, they impress prospects, prospective clients, when they search for your business. So back to that example, when I was referred to Andrew and Ben, if I search for the two business names, Berry and Oak and Coordinate Wealth, those Google reviews will come up on the right-hand side. They'll come up on the right-hand side. And that will immediately impress me. That's the first online interaction I have had with the business. And I am immediately impressed by the reviews that are there. And that's why they are so important. Google reviews are incredibly important for those reasons. Helps your local rankings, also impresses people on that first digital interaction on that journey to your door. And I get that they're hard to get, but I can think of some really good examples of firms. Go and search for South Devon Financial Planning. That's Charlie Brown, unsurprisingly based in South Devon. And South Devon Financial Planning, Charlie's a sole planning firm, and he's got 50, 60 reviews now. He's worked really, really hard, and it works brilliantly for him. Go and look at someone like Henwood Court, the Aspire Partnership. These firms have all got decent numbers of Google reviews. So that's why Google reviews are important. Vouched for. Now, our view is that you should always have a partner platform to Google. You should always use a second platform. And that's because Google reviews are hard to get. And if you only ask for Google reviews and your client can't or won't leave a Google review, you've set them down a dead end. They want to leave a review. They're really happy with you. But they can't or don't want to leave a Google review. You've just sent them down a dead end. So therefore, logically, we need a second platform. We've done a lot of research considering what that second platform should be. Should it be Facebook, FIFO, VouchedFor, Trustpilot, LinkedIn, endorsements, still a thing? Which do you use? And we've come to the conclusion a few years ago now, and it's something we test on a regular basis. We've come to the conclusion in the vast, vast majority of cases, VouchedFor is the right platform to use. Few reasons for that. They are easier to get than Google reviews. Doesn't mean Google reviews are any less important, just means they're easier to get. VouchedFor will, if you use it properly, generate a handful of leads and new inquiries each year, which, if you convert one of them, will probably cover the cost of your VouchedFor subscription. They also fulfill a slightly different function. So in that example before with Ben and Andrew, and I'll stop picking you on in a minute, Ben and Andrew. If I Google Andrew or Ben's name rather than their business name, their VouchedFor reviews will come up. So I'm covering two bases. The Google reviews cover the base if I'm Googling this firm's name. The VouchedFor reviews cover the base if I am Googling the individual advisor or planner's name. So really important that we collect reviews on both platforms. Now, to deal with your question, David, to deal with your question about overkill, I think it's all in how you do it in the process. So a lot of advisors think, a bit like you, David, that it's overkill to say, please leave a review on VouchedFor, then go back in a bit and ask for a review on Google. So what we suggest is best practice, and we see work really well, is, and which we'll talk about in a bit, the advisor, the planner, asks the client verbally, is it okay to send you an email asking for Google and VouchedFor reviews? Client will nod and say yes. And then you send them an email. We use two platforms, Google and VouchedFor. Here's the link for Google. Here's the link for VouchedFor. Some will do none. Some will do one. Some will do both. But that's the way to do it. One email with two links. The wrong way to do it is two emails with a link in each. So hopefully that answers your question, David. Dan, what was the third question? It's gone.
So the three main ones were reviews disappearing, overkill having both platforms, and then just basic trouble getting people to leave them in the first instance.
Yeah. Okay. We'll cover that one up at the end when we do the reviews. Okay. So that's why we believe you should use two platforms. Dan, anything in the chat that we need to deal about specifically around two platforms?
No, let's move on. There's a couple of great points here, but it's overlap of what's already been said in various instances.
Right. So use Google, use VouchedFor. If anybody has got any questions for that, any challenges around that, then put them in the chat and we'll deal with those. So if we accept that, collecting the reviews is great, but it's only half the job. And we need to repurpose the Google and VouchedFor reviews to maximize the impact of them and maximize your time and your investment producing them. And that's why we've got 10 ways that you can do this. You can repurpose them to maximize your impact and maximize the investment. So number one, on your website. So your website, as we've said lots of times, is your shop window. It's not an online brochure. It's not an online business card. It's so much more important than that. It's your shop window. It's where prospective clients get to know you. It's where prospective clients make decisions about whether you are the right advisor or planner for them. And it's a one-way conversation. It's a one-way street. You have no right of reply. So they will draw conclusions from what they see on your website, and you never know what conclusions they've drawn, whether they're good or bad. And therefore, we need to impress people when they're on your website. We need to empathize with them, and we need to show them that you are the right firm for them, or not, as the case may be, to be fair. Let's assume the prospect that's on there is a right fit prospect. So testimonials pages on advisor websites are dead. They are pointless. Why? Because only one or two out of every 100 visitors will ever go to a testimonials page. You're effectively putting the good stuff on one page and hoping that somebody visits that page. Instead, we need to take a leaf out of commercial TV channels, the social media giants, and scatter the social proof throughout the site. So if you imagine your Facebook feed, scrolling down your Facebook feed to find out what's happening with the people you're connected to. Every so often, Facebook, actually not every so often, it's probably every three posts, will insert an advert. And that means I see the advert while I'm scrolling. Some of the adverts I'll just scroll past, some I'll stop and look at, and some I will click. And we need to use that concept on your website. And throughout the site, we need to scatter, add, distribute, whatever word you want to use, your social proof, client surveys, client survey results, client stories, online ratings and reviews throughout your website. So people see them wherever you go or wherever they go on your site. And ideally, we should display ratings and reviews where possible, and I can't think of many occasions when it's not possible, using the widgets that VouchedFor provide and potentially some of the free widgets that you can get to display your Google reviews. And where should we put them? So the Google reviews should go on the homepage, as should the VouchedFor reviews. If you're displaying your VouchedFor reviews, there's two different widgets that you can use. And what I mean by the VouchedFor widget is when you click on it, you don't get redirected to the VouchedFor website, a pop-up appears. So I'm still in your website's domain. A pop-up appears and I can read the reviews. So on the homepage, we should display Google reviews and your company's VouchedFor reviews. Your website should have a Why Choose Us page. It's the bit where you are selling. And clearly your Google and VouchedFor reviews should go there. I'm a big fan of, and we've started to do this more often, of putting reviews on contact pages or get in touch pages. We've not always done it, but we've started to do it more often now and put them on there. Your website might have an awards and accreditations page. So I'd put your Google reviews there. And your website certainly should have a team section, then individual pages for each financial advisor, each financial planner in the business. And on those pages, you should use the vouched for advisor widget. So those are what we got there. Four or five different pages where we should be displaying the reviews as a minimum on your website. Dan, I can see a few things coming in the chat. I fancy some tea. How are we getting on?
Yeah, have yourself a sip of tea. We've got plenty of great questions coming through. So where do we start now? So on the testimonials pages being dead point, Hannah raises a great point. Should we put testimonials throughout the website and on a testimonials page for the sake of that 1% who want to read testimonials deliberately?
I wouldn't get too... Yes, you're going to do no harm doing it. Personally, I wouldn't put testimonials on a website. I think they are kind of the base level of social proof. Online ratings and reviews, videos, and client survey results, far, far, far more powerful than a written testimonial. But if testimonials are all you've got, scatter them around the site and give yourself a testimonials page. But then have a think about actually the quality of social proof that we have got and whether we should be raising that up a few notches through ratings, reviews, videos, and surveys.
Brilliant, thanks. Now, Claire asks a question. Why are vouched for reviews easier to get than Google reviews?
It's a good question, because instinctively they should be harder. Google, you're answering two questions, a star rating out of five and writing a comment. Vouched for, you're answering 8-10 questions, as well as rating on 4 different categories. So I would say there's a few reasons. I think the first one is, the main one is, you need a Google account to leave a Google review. And that means primarily you'll have a Gmail address. One thing I would say, slight tangent, is we do hear a lot of advisors saying, right, I've just got all my client lists and I've just highlighted the ones with a Gmail address. Don't do that. Few reasons. A, they might have another email address you don't know about as a Gmail account. Second, they might have a company email address that actually is run on the Gmail platform, Yardstick for an example. And third, they might love you so much that they go and set up a Gmail account or Gmail email address just to leave you a review. So I think the first reason is that, and that's the main barrier, is that you've got to have a Gmail account to leave the review. Second, your Gmail account, it's probably linked to your own name. Some people won't want their own name appearing in public. Vouched for reviews are anonymous. And the third is just the journey. With Google reviews, you leave a star rating and then you've got to write a comment. And that comment is just, you're just faced with a blank white box. Whereas vouched for, you are guided through questions. So I think those are the three reasons. Cannot emphasize enough that those three reasons are not a good enough reason to use Google. Huge benefits of using Google for reviews.
Brilliant, thanks. Good question from Bobby. What do you mean by video testimonials?
So it's a good question, Bobby. And what do we mean by video testimonials? We mean a interview with a client that is maybe 2 to 3 minutes in length, talking about their story or their journey with the advisor. So why they've started working with the advisor, the benefits of working with that advisor, the value that the advisor adds, etc. We record them sometimes face-to-face, sometimes remotely, and then add them to the website. A couple of examples. Go and have a look at the Delaunay Wealth website. That's a website we built this year, or launched this year. And we went and interviewed the advisor's clients in their home or workplace. And go and have a look at the Expert Wealth website. That's got some videos on it where we have done them remotely.
And just for everyone's benefit, I'm going to put those links in the chat now as well, so you can just all take a look. And on that theme, Phil, do you have any examples? So this is a question from Ravenska. Do you have any examples of companies that display Google reviews on websites?
Go and have a look at the Henwood Court website, scroll down on the homepage. you'll see Google reviews being displayed there on a slider.
Perfect.
I think on the Delaunay Wealth website as well, but Dan, maybe you can look for that while we're...
Yeah, we'll put those links in as well, so everyone's got those. Okay, well, that's it for the questions right now. Let's move on.
Okay. So, number one, that's where to display these reviews on your website. But there's a bunch of other things we can be doing with them. So, your social media banners. And what we mean by social media banners is the image that's displayed at the top of your LinkedIn profile, both your personal and corporate, Twitter, Facebook, etc. And the banner is so important because everybody sees it. Everybody who visits those social channels will see the banner. And that makes it really valuable online real estate. But too many firms, too many advisors and planners don't maximize the potential. So I looked at one the other day. It was nice. It's got the firm's logo on it. But it was ineffective because it was a missed opportunity. And Dan and his team spend a lot of time building social media banners in the branding team. And there's essentially four things that should be included. Your logo, a hero statement explaining what you do and who you do it for, your contact details, and some social proof. Your ratings and reviews, primarily. So if you just go and look at my LinkedIn profile, you'll see our banner. It's got a strap line on there. It's got our contact details. It's got our logo. And it's got our Google review count on there. So really important that you display your ratings and reviews or some form of social proof on the social media banners. And Dan, they don't take that long to do they?
No. So for a full suite of banners, and that's usually a LinkedIn banner for your personal account and then a LinkedIn banner for your corporate account, because the two have different sizes and have different things on them. And then perhaps a Twitter equivalent and a Facebook equivalent. It's usually around 2 or 3 hours of design time for the full set. And that's just at our standard agency rate of £71 plus VAT per hour. So for a full suite of useful social media banners, it's not really a big investment in the grand scheme.
Cheers, Dan. So number two, social media banners. Number three, your proposal documents. So as we talked about a lot already, and we'll carry on talking about showing the value of working with you, showing the value of financial advice, financial planning, beats telling people about it. And social proof is the best way of showing value. And there may be occasions when you write proposal documents for clients. I could think of one firm we've been working with recently where we've been helping them write their first meeting presentation and the follow-up proposal documents, which they will, we're going to put into a system called Better Proposals, which is an online proposal software application that allows you to write proposals, build template proposals, write them, send them out to clients and get them signed. If anybody's worked with the Arstic agency on the call, you'd have probably received a proposal via that system. And you're still in selling mode at that moment. I make no apologies for saying it. Everybody is selling something. And you're selling financial advice, financial planning, mortgage advice, yardstick. We're selling marketing services. So when you're sending that proposal document across, you're still in selling mode and you still should be in showing mode as well, not telling. And that's where social proof has a huge benefit, hugely important. So include social proof in your proposal documents, whether it's a PDF, a Word document, or you're using a system such as Better Proposals. And one of the types of social proof you should be using in there is, of course, your online ratings and reviews. If you use something like Better Proposals, you can put code in there, you can put HTML code in there, which means that you could probably use the Google and VouchedFor widgets to make them dynamic, which would look very cool. So your proposal documents, make sure you're putting social proof in there, including your online ratings and reviews. Social media. So we talked about banners, and that's improving the look of the static page. When you get a review, whether it's on Google or Vouched For, unless you publicize it, it's just going to sit on those platforms. So one of the key ways of publicizing this sort of stuff is on social media. Now, I know a lot of people struggle with self-promotion. They struggle to promote themselves. They struggle to talk about their wins. But really important that we're not shy. Because if you don't promote the reviews, nobody else is going to do it for you. So be aware of when a review comes in. Write a reply, talk more about that in a bit, and then go and promote it on your social media channels. You've got to be a little bit careful not to overdo it. You don't want every single post to be, look how great I am, we've had another review. And that's why we have something called the 8-1-1 rule. So for every 10 posts, 8 add value, you're imparting knowledge, you're giving away information. 1 is a bit about the business. 1 is a humble brag, a boast, we've had a review. And if you follow, not set in stone, but if you follow that broad ratio, then you won't be overdoing it. You'll still be adding value the majority of the time, but you'll also be promoting your reviews to demonstrate your expertise. So don't be shy. Nobody else is going to promote these for you. Really important you do it yourself. Social media is a great way of doing it. Just don't overdo it and follow that 8-1-1 rule. Company literature. Now, company literature is a deliberately broad term. I'll go to Dan in a second and get Dan to just explain what it might involve. But it's often designed in part to sell your services. And again, we've mentioned it a few times already, that showing beats telling. And therefore, find ways of working social proof into your company literature. And of course, those online ratings and reviews are one of the key, one of the three key social proof types of social proof we would expect you to include. So have a look at your company literature and have a look at where you could include Google reviews and your Vouched For reviews, either dynamically using the widget or if you're printing, icons and imagery. Dan, where have you done this for firms with in their literature?
So by company literature, generally speaking, it's things such as client agreements, fee agreements, disclosure documents, anything that you issue a client that they need to read, sometimes sign, but not always. And some clients that I've spoken to argue that it feels a bit salesy to put these in, because at this point, the client has technically, well, generally already onboarded or is onboarding. But I'd argue that it's not really about selling at this stage. It's about reassurance. And the client needs to feel that they're in safe hands. And your words can only do so much. The words of other people in the situation exactly the same as that person will carry far more weight. So the approach that we generally take is kind of like the website, where rather than have a page of testimonials right at the end, pepper them through. There's bound to be some natural breaks during the document, little bits of blank space. Usually we put imagery in there or icons and, you know, graphics, but a nicely designed testimonial or a Google review, or even just a widget saying your, you know, Vouched For rating, and perhaps a little passage explaining what that is generally quite a nice thing to do. It's all about being just quite subtle and putting it in fairly often and naturally. And when you've got a suite of, say, 3 or 4 documents that you give a client over the duration of their onboarding process, it does tend to be well received.
Thanks, Dan. While you were talking, I just took the opportunity to look at a question from David. And David asks whether you can embed widget code in your social media banners. The answer, unfortunately, David, as far as I know, is no, you can't do that. It's got to be a static image.
Yeah, it's all about flat imagery with banners. And that's not to say that will always be the case. They're always tinkering with the dimensions and the resolutions and et cetera to our to the displeasure of the designers that built them, because the rules change often. But at the moment, you can put videos into your profile picture in LinkedIn, but you can't put any widgets or any interactive elements in the actual banners.
Thank you, Dan. Right, number six, email signatures. So your email signature is seen by lots of people every week, clients, prospects, professional connections. So make it work for you. You've got to be a little bit careful about complacency here. I've seen a few firms put a line in there that might say, please leave us a Google review or please recommend people to us. And then kind of think that's enough and don't go off and do anything else. And then wonder why they don't get referrals or Google reviews. But your email signature is seen by so many people. We really should make it work for you. I don't know if you'd agree with this, but I would say with email signatures that less is more, because they have to be displayed in just thousands of different devices. And the more complex an email signature is, the more likely it is to break or not display properly. But I would say make it work for you by including your ratings and reviews there. Number seven, company updates. So all the evidence we see is that if you are writing blogs and articles, I'm using those words interchangeably here, clients want to see content about three different things: financial planning, financial advice, what you do, lifestyle stuff, give them a bit of a break, and news about your business. And therefore, one of the key things you could be talking about in the news about your business, apart from people being hired, leaving, jumping out of airplanes to charity, that sort of stuff, is we've had more reviews. Five more Google reviews, 20 more VouchedFor reviews, click here to read them. If you haven't left us a review yet, we'd appreciate you doing it. So if you write updates about your business, either every month, every quarter, every 6 months, how often you do it, include an update on how you're getting on the review front. It will provide reassurance to those people that already work for you or work with you. It will provide a gentle nudge in your direction to prospects, people who haven't signed up yet, but you do want to work with. And it will provide an equally gentle nudge to clients who have promised to leave you a review but haven't got around to it yet. So for example, on the nudge front, nudge theory, we got a client in the US who hadn't left us a review recently, promised to do it. He hadn't done it. He'd asked for the link a couple of the times. I'd sent in the link a couple of the times, but I wasn't about to nudge him. He's busy and I didn't want to pressure him. A few days ago, I retweeted one of his tweets. Immediately, he sent me a little message to say, sorry, I've not done the review. Have you got the link? Send it to me now and I'll do it now. And you know what? He did. Yeah. So little nudges are incredibly important. You can nudge about one thing and get something different back. Meeting presentations. If you are doing a kind of introductory presentation to a prospect, you're sat with them at the first meeting, you've got a introductory presentation, then put your reviews in there. It'll, as Dan said, provide reassurance. And if you're a yardstick client and we do a quarterly referral and recommendation communication for you, we would talk about reviews in there as well. Animations. Another different way of displaying reviews. So we use animations to often display client survey results. So if you go and look at the Berry & Oak website, you go and look at the Ardent website, and you will see animations that we have done to display client survey results. That concept of animations could be used to display your Google and VouchedFor reviews. Short clips scrolling through of the reviews with quotes from clients would be incredibly effective. And we use animations and have done for a couple of years now to promote a firm's top rated status. So a bunch of firms qualify for top rated status in the VouchedFor guide published in the Times every year. And for those who are yardstick clients, they get a little animation from us, three slides talking about their inclusion in the guide. So animations, just another nice way of displaying the reviews, taking the same information, repurposing it in a different way. Number nine, when you confirm meetings with new clients. So there will be new inquiry comes in, they agree to a meeting, you agree to see them, and there'll be a communication going out, I'm sure, confirming that meeting, the time, the place, the parking arrangements, that sort of stuff, practical information. But there's no guarantee that the prospect will actually convert when you see them. So we still need to keep convincing them that they have found the right financial expert. We still need to show them, that word again, that they're in the right place. And one of the ways of doing that is to include social proof in your meeting confirmations. So as I say, you've got the email going out, time of the appointment, location, Zoom link, Teams link, parking information, whatever it is. Then just finish it off with your some social proof. Just want to show you how we've helped John and Jane, who are like you. Here's a couple of reviews from John and Jane. Here's a video for somebody else who was in a similar situation. Just to reassure the client or prospect at that point that they're in the right place, they've found the expert that they need, and you're showing them, you're proving to them your expertise in working with people like them. And I have a theory, a hypothesis, that meeting confirmations aren't as effective as they could be in continuing that selling process. And then when the prospect turns up for the meeting in your office physically, let's use that experience, that physical journey, sat in your reception or in a meeting room, to again continue the confirmation that they're in the right place. So in your reception, you could create the equivalent of a hotel guest book, hotel comments book, by leaving a folder of your reviews in reception or in the meeting room. So most small boutique-y kind of hotels, B&Bs, have got some sort of guest book, comments book, etc. I can think of one place where I go and stay on a pretty regular basis when Sarah and I need a bit of a break. It's down the A1. It's a place called the Olive Branch. And Dan's been there. He nodded. And upstairs in the Olive Branch, there's 5 bedrooms. There's a little guest book. And you write your comment in there. But you go and look at what other people have said, don't you? Yeah. You go and look at the nice things other people have said. So let's take that concept and put it into your business. And in your reception area or in your meeting room, have a folder of reviews from clients. Then display the certificates that VouchedFor give you, the top rated certificates on the wall. And I would also be buying VouchedFor's top rated trophies as well and displaying those in the office. See behind me, I like a trophy. So put those in your office as well. But I don't see many firms doing these things. So again, would set you apart and help to show the prospect that they found the right expert and confirm to existing clients that you're actually really good at what you do. But not every meeting, of course, takes place in your office. Some of those meetings now will take place by Zoom or Teams. So my bonus number 11 tip is to use the virtual background. So if you're going to have a virtual background, put it to your advantage. Use it as an opportunity to show off your reviews. A little Google 5-star logo, VouchedFor top rated logo, your VouchedFor score, and I don't know, your company logo as well. And again, this is just another good way of convincing people that they're in the right place. Dan, these don't take long either, do they?
No. I mean, I was looking earlier at the average time taken, and it's around an hour. Yeah. And it's because you don't really want to show a lot because you're the focus of the conversation. You don't want things to be distracting. But just subtly placing a few key markers around the space that you've got. About 1 hour for that, I'd say quite easily.
Thanks, Dan. So There were 11 ways, because you've got the bonus tip, 11 ways of, as Dan said earlier, weaponizing your Google and Vouched For reviews. But obviously, going back to basics, we need to get these reviews in the first place. So a couple of tips, a couple of ways, best practice to increase the number of reviews you've got. So first thing, adopt two platforms. Cannot emphasize enough how important it is to use two platforms. David, you get around that issue of overkill by just using one email with two links. And we've done a lot of projects and we've never had any pushback. So just mentally accept that you've got to use two platforms. And then what I would do is an initial booster project, which is where you invite all your clients at the same time to leave a review on both platforms. So we send the initial email out, send a reminder. Here are the two links. And you always see an increase in the number of reviews that the firm has. The latest project we did at the weekend was for a firm in the east of the country. Unfortunately, they only got one Google review, but they picked up 34 on Vouched For. 34 reviews in 2 days on Vouched For. Really, really very good. And the other thing to remember, just as a slight tangent, is that Vouched For's algorithm is partly based on quality of reviews, partly based on the quantity of reviews, and partly based on the recency of reviews. So all other things being equal, advisor or planner with the more recent reviews are more likely to rank well in Vouched For's algorithm. So the initial booster project, send an email out to all clients at the same time, asking for reviews on both platforms. Send it once, send a reminder, and then go and leave replies. Really important that you leave replies. A couple of audiences, the client who left the review, and prospective clients who read the review. Your reply should be detailed. It should reference what the client has said. If you stick with referencing what the client said, you're not going to break any confidences. And talk about benefits. Always, always, always talk about the benefits of that client got from working with you in your reply. And then secondly, once you've done the booster project, keep your reviews topped up. New clients, when they've been onboarded, ask them for a review at that point. Do not send a survey out. Chances are they will not complete it. You know, that compliance survey, did we give you the terms of business? Did you understand fees, etc.? Chances are they will not complete that. So don't send that out. But do send a Google and Vouched For review request, two links, one email. Chances are they'll do one of those. And there is no better time than when you've onboarded a client to ask for a review. I've seen some advisors say, I'm going to wait 12 or 24 months before sending a review request. Let them feel the benefit of working with me. Well, they should have already felt the benefit of working with you when you've just onboarded them as a client. So ask at that point. Ask your existing clients after their periodic review meeting. So for some advisors, that's every 6 months or every 12 months. Some advisors, planners call it a future planning meeting, whatever it is, your periodic review meeting. In the meeting, ask if they're happy to leave a review. If they say yes, send the email. One email, two links. Really important that it follows that cadence. Verbal request by the advisor, follow up by email. Ideally, that email should come from the advisor, should have the two links in it. It should be only, solely, exclusively about the reviews. So I've seen a few advisors tag the review request onto the end of their suitability letter. That's not going to get any review requests. Chances are the client's not going to get to the end of the suitability letter to see the request for the Google and Vouched For reviews. I've seen a couple of advisors ask for reviews via the their online portal. It's too much friction involved. Simply ask one email, two links, emails exclusively and wholly about the Google and Vouched For reviews after your annual review meeting. And again, leave replies. Really important that we leave detailed replies showing the benefits of working with you. And that's it, guys. What have we talked about today? So we've talked about why reviews are important. We talked about why we should be using two platforms, in our view, Google and VouchedFor. We talked about 10 ways, 11 ways actually, we can maximize, or in Dan's words, weaponize your reviews. We talked about where they can be added to the website. And then finally, kind of the process for boosting the number of reviews that you've got. Really happy to hang around and take questions. As I say, we're off in August, so no webinar August. We are back in September with a bang. And I would like your help, please. I've just launched another poll. And I want to know what you want us to talk about on these webinars. So would you like us to talk about how we show value to prospective clients, how to position fixed fees, how to communicate around stock market volatility and high interest rates? Or do you want something else? If you want something else, vote something else and put it in the chat to tell us. But really, really keen to understand what you want these webinars to be about. So vote in the poll if you would. We'll send the follow-up out today. There is a cheeky request at the top of that follow-up. If you find these webinars useful, so just click the link and go and leave us a Google review. Takes you 2 minutes, but means the world to me and Dan. Put a smile on Dan's face and my face. If you want to connect with us and you haven't already, there's the website address. There's my LinkedIn profile, my email address and Twitter account. If anybody knows whether England or Australia have won the toss in the Ashes, put something in the chat. I'd love to know what the answer is to that. Otherwise, really happy to answer any questions we've got. And Dan, I think there was one from Ravenska that I saw.
Yes. So before we get to Ravenska's question, David, we were speaking about widgets within social media banners. And then David asked a follow-up question about, he said, I presume then it's good practice to make sure periodically that review stats are accurate. And from our point of view, it's almost a common sense prevails mentality. So for example, if you look at our own social media banners, we've got 136 Google reviews, but every time we get a Google review, we don't want to be updating images within social media banners. So we just put 100 plus. And it might make sense when we do reach 150 to perhaps put 150 plus, then 200, because that feels good. But yeah, I mean, what's your verdict on that, Phil?
Yeah, I'd agree. The way we've got around it with Google on our The Artistic banner is we've just put 100 plus 5-star Google reviews. So yeah, I mean, I would update it every so often, David. I don't think anybody's going to go and say, your banner is always going to be underestimating the number you get. And no one's going to say, you said you've got 60 reviews, but I've gone to Voucher for one, I've got 85. So yeah, I wouldn't sweat that one too much.
Well, and then Ravenska's question, is it okay if we put the Google review link in our monthly newsletter?
Hi, Ravenska. Yes, it's absolutely okay. No issue with that whatsoever. But almost nobody will click it. Almost nobody will leave a review from it. You still need to do all the other stuff that we've spoken about before. So it is a little additional marginal gain, but it shouldn't stop you doing everything else.
Perfect. Phil, you'll be happy to know that England won the toss. So Australia to bat. And then on a slightly more relevant note, Matt, mentions that during this call he's already made changes to his booking process auto emails, so he's already actioned some of the stuff we've said, which is fantastic. And then Bobby asks, can I ask you to do a full review of my website and proposals? So Bobby, if you'd like to send Phil an email about that, and Phil, what's best to get you on? Do you want to go to the slide with your contact details on?
Yeah, of course. Bobby, just send us an email to phil@theartisticagency.co.uk address, and I'll be back in touch.
Lovely stuff. And that's it for questions. Unless there's any more for any more, we will see you in September.
Thank you, everybody. Have a good summer. Have a good break. See you in September. Cheers. Bye-bye.
Take care, guys. Bye.